No, I'm not streaming.
Am I in the way?
Recording for Donna.
Am I in the way?
No, sir. All everybody's right. Fine.
Thanks, everybody, for coming out tonight. We're going to have a really fun presentation on Ruby. Is it just Ruby or is it Rails? Just Rails.
Okay. Wait, you're not giving a presentation?
No, I'm doing that stuff.
Are you registered?
No.
You dress for it.
Anyway, I'm wearing you out. This isn't anyway. Shut up. Thanks for coming out tonight. This is second presentation of this year. Anyway, Jonathan, right, is gonna be giving us a presentation on Rails, hopefully using Ruby, so that we don't have to do anything too weird. For real, I want people to start talking about Ignite presentations. It's 5 minutes, 20 slides. So get in touch with us.
I'm on.
You're required.
I am.
All right. So I'm going to turn it over to John.
When is that?
Unless, Corey, you have something?
That's December, right?
That's
January.
January.
And we're
going to
do CGI.
CGI. So same set as last time. All right, turn it over to John.
We're going
to
turn the lights on?
Yes.
I can't see now.
I guess it's all right. I mean, I don't know.
Okay, so
we're going to
do some demo.
You sending an email to the demo gods?
Yes. I'm trying to figure out what my sacrifice will be. I think it's going to be one of you.
Hopefully, somebody closer to our seats.
Tell us more about NASA. So,
thanks everybody for coming today and to meet an interesting adventure. My name is Jonathan Wright. I'm a freelance web developer. I've been writing code on the web since about 2000. I was honored to work at ThoughtWorks and NASA. My audience today is Rails novices or skeptics. I was expecting Damien here, so I have a lot of jokes making fun of Damien, because he's a skeptic.
You can make him anyway.
Yes, that will not stop me. If any of you were here for my RESTful Resources presentation, which was a couple months ago, or a year ago? Yes, it was actually last October. Did anybody witness that craziness? Okay. Keep that in mind. There's a lot of that sort of baked into Rails. But if you didn't experience it, generally the concept of RESTful resources is that on a website, you might have a single. How many people know what domain objects are? Like, all right, most people. If you're in the sales field, then your domain objects are products, carts, customers, orders, line items, that kind of thing. Just the words that you use to mean things, specific things in your industry. I would expect that you would have an endpoint, an address for most of those things in your API. And Rails is going to end up having that. And it's going to end up having models, but also endpoints that are very similar to that. So just keep that in mind as we go through. Rails is built on top of Ruby. They're not the same. There's a lot of like, oh, well, isn't it just Ruby on Rails and all one thing? It's not. Ruby was actually written around the same time as PHP. It's a dynamic, loosely typed language. And when you look at the code, it often reads a lot like English. It has an amazingly, I guess I would call it a kind API. When I've been working in C#, with .NET, a lot of times .NET, it will let you do whatever you want. If you want to stand on your one hand and put your foot up somebody's nose, whatever, you can get that done with C#. But you're going to have to use 15 classes and do some very awkward maneuvering. And in Rails, or in Ruby, a lot of the stuff that you want to do, just like, oh, I really wish I could just sort this by this field. And you just sort, and then you pass in the thing, the attribute you want to sort it by. It's just like, okay, I mean, this is kind of what I would expect. If somebody wants to sort something, and they give me something, I guess that's an attribute, I'll just do that. So a lot of the things that you might have to write out are already taken care of for you in Ruby stuff, you know, the 80% problem. So I genuinely, I find myself laughing sometimes. I'm like, ha, that was so easy. It makes me happy. Ruby on Rails, it's a web framework built out of best practices. A lot of people on Twitter, I see people on Twitter saying things like, I just got out and working in Node now, and I've forgotten Ruby. Rails makes you do things certain ways, and I'm free now. I'm like, those reasons, sir, those are best practices. Like, how long you been doing it? If you've been working for 20 years and you feel freedom, great. Okay, go ahead and use that. I'm sure it's going to be fine. But you're going to end up constraining yourself in ways because you know what's going to happen if you don't. And Rails is a lot like that. They have conventions. They're like, this is the way we're going to do it. And it works great. So that's something I really value about Rails. Rails is strongly opinionated. Naming conventions, models are always singular. The tables that they correspond with are always plural. Controllers are plural, blah, blah. And, oh, well, who cares? What does it matter? Well, if somebody comes in and decides, I want my model names to be plural, well, then you have to go configure that because Rails has to know, you know, oh, well, I've got a table named person, and I've got a table named people, I've got a model named people, what table does it associate with? So by it choosing that for you, it automatically can program how it knows what to do, and you don't have to go in and say, this is how you map models to tables. This is done for you. GEMS is a package management system that's been around for a long time. There's a tremendous number of gems. If you want to pull a Twitter feed or attach files or whatever with Rails or without Rails in Ruby, there's a gem to do just about anything you want to do. I wrote a gem that wraps the Netflix API. There's gems for almost everything. Migrations. A migration is a programmatic way to change a database. And it allows you to migrate up, which is to make a change and add something, or migrate back down. That same migration will have a recipe for how to add stuff to my database and remove stuff from it. And this allows you to, deploying to production is so much easier. But also, you write some code to add a field to a database, and somebody else writes some, and then you pull their stuff down. Well, all of a sudden, everything's broken because they added something to the database and they didn't tell you. But if you're using migrations, all you have to do is, oh, if there are any migrations, go ahead and run that. It's beautiful. Rails is strongly MVC. And another convention I really like about Rails is dry. Don't repeat yourself. So, for instance, models will look at the table to see what fields, what attributes they have, rather than use writing a migration that says, person has a name, and then also going to the person model and saying, oh, you have an attribute called name. That would be repeating yourself and also could put you in a situation where you're oddly out of sync. So Rails just looks at the database and says, oh, as I'm starting up, I see there's a people table, it's got a name, it's a string, got it, okay. That's gonna be a field. And an extensible directory structure that where models are always in app/model. Views are always in app/view. Now, you aren't required to do any of this. You could put your views in hijk element of p. But Rails is going to make it painful. Because why? Every Rails developer knows to look in app views for the view. Why would you put it in element of p? If you want to do that, go use some other framework that doesn't believe as strongly in conventions. Other than your ego, I have not found a good reason to stray from most conventions. All right, let's code. Now, who thinks I'm going to get through this without making any typos? Not me. So, I cheated very heavily by we're using git. And I have 8 checkpoints. And if I can't figure something out after glancing at it, we're just going to move to the next checkpoint, and that's all.
That's all. All
right, so when you're coding with Rails, the first thing you are going to do is to use the Rails command to create the directory structure of a blank application. So you're going to go Rails, new, blah, blah. And there it's added a whole bunch of files. And now it is doing the package management stuff, making sure all the versions are in sync and everything works together.
That Rails command you ran, that's just from installing the Rails gem on your system?
The Rails gem is installed on my system, that's right. And yes. So now we're in this, and you can see that there are a whole bunch of directories, and within app, there's a, but most of these are just blank. It's just ready for the application. Config has some stuff, and one interesting thing is their environment configuration. So, dev is your development is your normal here, my configuration here, and there's production, and I'll often create one called staging and edge. But most of my production configuration, I would say 90% of it is the Rails default. They just make good choices. They know what they're doing. So even though I can change a lot of stuff, I often don't. All right. So the next thing you do after you create a new application is start serving web pages. And I'm going to bind it to 0000 because by default for security, they don't want people hitting your development machine from outside and getting access to whatever you're doing. So I had to do that just to say it's okay for people outside to get this. Yeah, you're on Rails. So, I mean, it's not mind-blowing, but we are connected to the application. Did you guys prefer the yellow or the black? So, hello world. We'll just start with the basics. And in a model view controller application, when a request comes in, the request first goes to the controller. The controller takes care of authentication, authorization, loading the specific set of data, like for instance in a blog, it would be like, which posts can this user see? I'm going to filter out the ones that haven't been published yet. But if it's an admin, I'm going to let those through. That kind of stuff, all that lives in the controller. But anything else really does not belong in the controller and should be left out. That's why they say skinny controller, fat model. Is that right? Yes. Mm-hmm. All right, so I'm going to actually use Rails to generate a controller called pages. It's not a RESTful thing, it's just when there are pages of just pure content, I often just stash them in a pages controller. Rails generate controller pages. So you see it also creates tests for you and JavaScript assets and style sheet assets, but I'm not going to deal with any of that right now. I'm going to create a welcome page, and I'm going to render body hello world. And then I need to do one more thing. I need to go to the routes page, which just connects paths, URLs and paths to controllers. And I say the root of our application, goes to pages, but so I mean, nobody wants a Hello World application, but as Hello World applications go, not a lot of code to get from no web server to this is actually, you can hit this on your phones and hear that for. All right, so next.
Sure this is in order.
Yes, this is tag one, this is checkpoint one, yay. So this is not very attractive. How many people know what Bootstrap is? Good. Okay. So Bootstrap basically beautifies your web pages sort of for free. I am going to open my gem file, which is the place where you list all the gems, the packages you want to use.
And then I'm going to yellow whenever
yeah.
The dark text will start to read on the black.
People name unless.
Yeah. So swap over.
What's the question?
Can we move back to the yellow terminal? It's tough to read on the black with the dark letters.
Yeah.
Let's see. So I'm going to start my server over here. And then over here.
Controllers.
Thank you. I was doing gem.
So, thank you for the feedback. I want you to have to go through the whole thing and be like, oh, I didn't read any of what you were doing. So, I'm going to add two gems. Bootstrap generator. And this doesn't actually do anything as the application's running. It just gives me access to more generators. And then one called... Now I'm just going to run the bundle command. I'm just going to take care of all the dependencies. And it says you type something wrong. Okay. Now you know I'm not faking. Otherwise, I would not have made myself look dumb. So, I'm going to actually type Rails generate bootstrap install.
And that's right.
And it's going to add a whole bunch more files that are going to give me good stuff. But this one's the most interesting. The application layout. Obviously is going to wrap any of the smaller views that we do. Let's just look at the diff here, and you can see that it took a very small file, and it got rid of some of the stuff, it's just the spacing exchange, but it's added meta tags and all the bootstrap typical stuff that you have has been added here, some navigation, a container, all that. So, done that, and
what's Spring?
Spring is an annoying thing that I should have taken out when I first created this. It some kind of caching thing in Rails, and it's just going to get in my way right now, so I'm just gonna So, yes, right, so the view has not changed. So I go over here. Oh, it's exactly the same, Jonathan, you did not beautify. Right, okay, so that's because the controller specifically says, render this body and nothing else. So I'm just gonna change it to render. And then I'm gonna create a directory that corresponds, oh, right, it did that for me. Ah, thank you. App views, pages, welcome.html.erb. ERB is the template that comes automatically with Ruby, though there a lot of new ones have been. And I'm going to say h2.
add a new gem, obviously when you add, you know, totally new code, sometimes you have to restart the server. Not that often, but it does happen. All right, so now we've unified, we've added Bootstrap just by using a gem. So, but hello world, not very exciting. I did want to show you a little bit, one more thing about controllers. I don't have time to really focus on any one thing, but I did say authentication and authorization normally happens in a controller. Also, I should say one fun thing, Ruby methods can have exclamation points and question marks. So, especially those that return Booleans will have a question mark normally. And then I'm going to create a private method. And then let me just say, never do this. So. Slow. I knew why it was slow the other time because it was restarting the server, but nice, my connection's been awesome. Let's just try again. People ask why I use Windows, and the reason is because I'm a freelancer and my clients use Windows. And if my clients call me and say, it doesn't work for me, and I say, oh, well, it works for me, then that really is not a successful conclusion. All right, so go away. And then we apply our incredibly secure and now we are an admin. I've actually seen applications, if you search for admin equals true, Google has indexed some applications where there was a link somewhere that included admin is true. And you can go in there and, or at least that used to be true, maybe hopefully they fixed that.
Do the developers?
So, sometimes we have limited authorization, but let's get on to actually the work of creating a blog. So, the number one thing a blog needs is hosts, right? Rails generate scaffold. Scaffolding is the model, view, the controller, everything you would need to just get going. I rarely use scaffolding unless I'm doing something very simple. But then it just gives you everything and you don't have to, you know, you can make the few edits you need to do rather than trying to build everything from scratch. So I'm going to give it the name of this model. We're going to say post. And I'm going to say a post has a title and a body. And it's going to assume, if I don't tell it, that whatever I'm telling is a string. So this is text. And I'm going to say published
Boolean.
Now, normally I would actually, instead of doing a Boolean, I'd probably do like a published at and do a date time. But I just thought you'd be interesting to see, you know, do some, add the Boolean to the form. Let's just do that. So it's created a whole bunch of files, and then I'm going to go to the menu, and I'm going to replace this menu entry over here. What is it about? With log, and the post resource will be at posts, of course. So we reload this page. Oh, migrations are pending. To resolve this issue, do this command. Well, even a professional developer cannot pass up the chance to copy and paste. But I ran into that one on purpose, just so you guys would see. They really are trying to help people sort of not just be baffled. I wrote this migration, why didn't it work? So now I'm going to go to our blog page, and I'm going to say new blog. All right, title. First blog post. The title of everybody's first blog post. I am such an awesome blogger. Yo. I am a blog all the time, every single day. It's gonna be epic. You have no idea how epic. It's gonna be huge. Alright. And then, oh, I should have done a Boolean. That's funny. I love that. Okay. Anyway. So this isn't a very exciting page, but you can see the resources, /posts/1. So we've created a post, and we're on the page that shows you just that resource. We go to the index, you see the representation of the index resource is just a list. All right, so then I'm going to do another one, and I'm going to do two. In one day, I am so excited about blogging. Blogger. I have mad blogging skills. All right, so that's exciting. And then that. Second day, a new post. I'm gonna blog every day. Create a post. Back. Create a post. 1 week later, I was so tired from blogging, I had to catch up on my sleep. But I swear, every day from now on. I swear it. All right. So we've got some posts, and we have these representations. Maybe we should destroy this. We get rid of this one. It's a little bit ambitious. We were setting our readers' expectations too high by having two posts in one day. So automatically, I can delete things, create, read, update, destroy, just default from rest. And we have reached checkpoint 4. Yay! Look at the code, though, that I'm not writing. Okay? how much configuration am I not doing?
Alright, so I'm going to abstract some of this out. I'm going to say, I really don't like the index view tables, not very conducive to reading a blog. So Rails has written this index page for me, and I'm going to get rid of, maybe keep that.
But
I'm
going to
get rid of all
the bootstrap gem that caused it to output HTML with like the bootstrap classes.
That's right. So the bootstrap gem, the bootstrap generator, added a bunch of change. All it did was it changed the Rails generator. So now the Rails generator, instead of using its default generator, I've included some files in lib template, I don't remember where we're at, and those will be used. If I wanted to go through and customize it so that it always had an icon or an extra, I could totally do that. And all future generators that use that were at that location would use that custom, those custom files.
Is that the ERB?
ERB is the Ruby default templating language, but I'll show them to you in a minute. So I'm just going to use panels.
Does Rails use EPP also?
I don't know what that is, but if it is a common templating language, then probably someone wrote a gem to do it. Panel default, panel body. Alright, so now it's going to be in a panel. I wanted this inside the loop. And this is, that's their default. I wouldn't have done the default that way, but I turned up and fixed it. So for each post, this is the loop right here. It's a little bit strange. It's more of a functional syntax, but it's idiomatic Ruby. And then we go and do all the table stuff. This, and that. And that, and that. Alright, so now it's going to give us a title and a body, but I really want to put this in line 2. And then I'm going to use Rails has a bunch of useful view helpers, just methods that you can use to pivot things and do things. So I'm going to do one called simple format, which is just going to take enters and turn them into paragraphs and very simple stuff like that. And I don't really want to put the publication date on the index page because I don't want it. And then I'm going to put a rule. And this, again, I don't really want a show link. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I'm going to go up here and actually link to post title, post. I want the post title to link to the post, but I will keep the edit destroy links. So this loop closes here, and I need to close this panel. That's it. Let's see. Ta-da! So, not that this isn't something that comes from Rails, but I did want to show, this is just with Bootstrap, of course, but just to give you a sense for all of what we got with that, this is the mobile view. So, you're getting a lot. Now, go and look at the post. This page, still not attractive. And make sure that I'm going in the right order. So I'm actually going to go here, and I'm going to get rid of all this and this, and I'm going to write this to app views posts post. And this is the default place where if you tell Rails, I'm not saying how you should render it, just go show me what that is. Here's a post, render that. I'm not going to tell you where to render it from, where the view is. It's going to look for the plural, within the view for that thing. It's going to look for that. And so I'm going to save that there. And I'm going to go out here and I'm going to get rid of all this. And I'm going to actually.
actually just say render hosts. And then I'm going to go reload this index. And it still works. And anywhere in the program, if I had like three posts that I wanted to put on a single page somewhere, I could easily just get a collection of those three, render those three posts, and it would just use this to render. Okay, so this is almost tag 5. All
right,
so let me go in and show, and you know, we want to do this one differently. So I'm going to change this show post, which is the title, to post.title. And then I'm going to do this. We don't need to tell them it's the body because they can't tell that. No. Having some trouble. Simple format. And then, you know, one thing I'd like to do is tell them when it was published. So we could put the publication date here, but let's just be a little fancy and say time ago in words. Post.published at, was it called that? So, published 11 minutes ago. Oh no, I need to add the word ago. I always forget that. I expected to put it because it put everything else. Published 11 minutes ago. All right, and of course, as that changes, it'll be like 3 days ago. 1 year ago, 1 year, what I had a year and a half ago. Good, so that was three, some basic views, add a bit more stuff. Time to go, good, tag 5, we are doing awesome. What are we doing on time, 36 minutes? Only 5 minutes behind is great. Okay, now we haven't done anything with the models and relationships, so I thought we'd do something with that. So we're going to do Rails, G for generate, scaffold for comments. I'm going to do a comment, and we're going to do post ID, and we're going to do an author, and we're going to do a body. Okay? And we aren't going to go in the database and create a foreign key. And a lot of people have a problem with that. You do need to create indexes at some point, and that's a thing you can easily do. But Rails likes to manage the foreign keys by itself. I've actually gone through and created private keys at some point in the past, and then I try to create, delete something. And because you had to delete things in a certain sequence or whatever, it became a problem. So we just don't. And there's some discussion of integrating private foreign keys into the Rails migrations. But in general, I mean, as long as you just create indexes, I haven't had any problems with it. It seems to work fine. So to each his own on that. I'm going to copy the form that was created. App views, comments, form. Because it's not like I asked people to go into the comments resource and then pick a post and then create a, that doesn't really, you know, that workflow doesn't work. So in this sense, what Rails has done is it assumed that comments was a first order resource. And it's not. The generators just don't, there's not a generator for nested resources, and I'm fine with that because often the nested resources get into a situation where they're relatively different. So
copy that to app views host comment form. And then this is a partial, so it has an underscore. Because it is nested, I'm actually going to have to do comment.new host is that post. And to get rid of this, it's just overly just making things even more complicated than we need to. Now, one thing it's going to ask is it's going to give you a field and say, hey, what's your post ID? But obviously, you know, having users select their post ID, maybe not the best user experience. So Rails will know what the post ID is because I've given it the post right here, so I'm just going to make that hidden. The rest of this seems fine. So I'm going to go into here, and I'm going to say, okay, now H2 comments, and we know everybody, especially Damon, likes to make comments. So render partial post comments form, is that what I call it? Migration. Okay. What did I call it? It says that's not there. Comment form. I called it comment, and then I called it comments. Yes, okay, thank you. So, we are modeling things. We have a post model, and the post model needs to know that there are comments. Now, Jonathan, you said migrations, and you don't need to... But we didn't tell Rails how they were related to each other. We do need to do that. We don't need to tell what attributes we put on the comment field. But we do need to say, posts, even though there's a post ID, come on, you know, here's how you're related to comments. So, has many comments. And comments belongs to post. And you can do things like put things in order. Like I could have said, order the comments by publication date or by the date they were created or whatever. But so, all right. So now we can add comments, and we're gonna get. Comment from Damien is, I am skeptical. Oh, this blog post, that is not very good. Also, this is a terrible user experience. We're taking them to /comment/1. I would totally have expected them to go back to that post, right? I thought I saw it say this blog post, but I guess not. All right, anyway, so... app controllers comments. So I'm going to go to the comments controller, which remember I said when a request comes in, it goes to the controller first. And the controller does authentication, authorization, it loads the data, and sometimes instead of loading data, it's like you need to be over there. So when you create something, if the creation succeeds, if it saves, then redirect to the comment page, but we don't want to. We want to redirect to the post for that comment. So let's try again, and we'll say, Damien again, I think you are going to be a terrible blogger. Nasty blog. What are you guys laughing about? That is not funny. Calling people nasty is not polite. Okay, so, we're just going to create, this is the same format. When you want to render a
comment, you're going to go to comment slash comment. That's just where it is. So we're going to create a div and alert, alert info. And I'm just going to put the comment author said. Page and nothing happens because we didn't tell Rails to render comments. We told it how to, but not that it should. Use post show. I'm going to go down here and I'll put it above the comment form so that everyone can get angry reading other people's comments before they post their own. And nice. I saw you doing something, I was like, am I boring him? And I appreciate the spelling of my name. Sense to have a blog post with no title, right? We need titles. Let's say validates presence of title. And validates presence of like post. I mean if you can tweet, you must be an intelligent person. So we could say that the minimum number of characters is used to be 140. Did they expand it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or is that something you're talking about?
It's 280 now.
Somebody read, there was an announcement that they did and it used up almost 280 characters talking about how great it was, and then somebody edited it to like down to 140 characters, and if you read it, it was basically the same. So, yeah. So we'll say a minimum of 100, well, it's not a minimum, I guess that's a maximum. We'll say minimum of 10 characters, maximum of 140 characters, because, I mean, even like a famous person could find something to say in 140 characters. All right, so if we were to from the blog post, oh, I'm right there. And say I try to create a post now, what do you guys think is going to happen? Gonna kick it back, but I mean, we haven't created any kind of UI around giving the user feedback. So it's gonna be a really problematic user experience, right? Let's see, create this. Rails tells us this. Now, I do it a little bit differently. I use a tool where my template actually colors the field and puts it down here, and then it says, I just like it to be in line so they don't actually have to go looking for it, but you're automatically going to get human-readable error messages. And actually, this is fun. We do it like this. It's going to say, who wants to see? Oh, never mind. I should just stop. Let's say someone wants to syndicate our blog because our content it's mad. I've got mad skills. Clearly, you know, after 3 posts, 4 posts. So I'm going to be syndicated. And what do we need in order to be syndicated? We need some kind of feed, right? So XML used to be popular, but let's say JSON. Rails will read your attributes and automatically generate serialization. You can turn it off if you want, but by default, it's going to give that to you. And then, in this case, it was actually part of the scaffolding, but it doesn't have to be. You can get serialization in much easier ways sometimes, but it's harder to customize. So we're going to go to the post JSON. And we're just going to say json.comments, post.comments. So the JSON field called comments will be post.comments, json.hello. So comments are now nested. And then there's my hello, hi there. So it's fairly customizable. It's pretty easy to do easy stuff. I think the basic takeaway for Rails should be, when you know what you're doing, easy stuff should be easy. Easy stuff should not be like .NET, okay? I really like C#, so I'm not down on C#. .NET, I mean, you want to get user input from a console, and you have to use like 5 different classes and like find 3 different tutorials to get it just okay. Easy stuff should just be easy. All right, so then my big plan had been to go to Wikipedia and get their serialization. So I'll just show you what it is, but I'm not going to code it. Wikipedia, and then I'm going to get RSS feed. That's what I'm
doing. It brought up serial.
Serial killer. Yeah. Somebody's gonna go put a blog post about serial killers.
I love serial.
Alright, so recent changes, new pages. So go over here, and then here is the Wikipedia page. So imagine, if you will, that I had copied all this and then pasted it into a file, and I'm just going to go to the next checkpoint, and magically it will appear. And that is checkpoint 7. And then I need to. I do want to show you the migrations, but I have to delete these for some reason. I mean, I don't know what the reason is, but I don't want to explain it. I have to delete them because I use because I'm skipping ahead, and so the date timestamps on the files will be wrong. And so Rails is going to want to run those migrations again. But if I run the migrations again, it's going to say, I already have a table called posts. What's wrong with you? So anyway, this is what the migrations look like. This is the programmatic way. And it used to be that it had an up and a down, which might have been a little bit more clear to people who weren't using it. But what I know is that when this migration goes up, it's going to create that table. When it goes down, it's going to drop that table. And so I have to remove these. And then I'm going to show you use post index.rss. And so if I copied all that stuff and pasted here, and then just, you know, changed it a little bit, this is the only thing that's most interesting. Rails has, this is not actually a collection of posts. It's a lazy reference object. And so it's still connected to its database query. So if I say, give me the maximum of the field updated at, it's going to give me the last time a post was updated. And you can use that to determine for yourself whether you need to refresh your cache of my syndication or whatever. But post URL is going to be a dynamically generated helper method. It's going to say, OK, you're going to give me a post. I'm going to give you the URL for that post. If I put path instead of post, it's just going to give me everything after the first. So we got that.
And then I go over here and I'm gonna change this to, so this is the JSON representation of the post's resource, right? And now we're gonna look at the RSS representation of the post resource. And there it is. And that's it. So that's Ruby on Rails. Any questions?
What's the database that it uses? I kept seeing the DB.
Good question. Thank you. So Rails can use a number of different databases, and your migrations don't change, and your queries don't change unless you're doing custom queries that are like, you know, sometimes queries are specific, like the it's top 10 in SQL Server, but it's limit 10 in MySQL. So other than that kind of stuff, and Rails knows that, but if you actually go in and write the string, top 10, it won't be like, oh, hey, you're done, I'm gonna change that. Other than that, Rails can use SQL Server, MySQL, Postgres, and 3 to 5 other ones. I'm using SQLite because it's a file-based database, so, and I've got Git, so when I change to my different checkpoints,
sure,
it'll automatically change my database with it. And you can see the database here. I mean, it's not perfect, but you can see.
Is that a normal workflow for releases to automate Git, basically updating the database for you? And
so Git isn't updating my database. Using migrations is a normal workflow. I absolutely do that on every project. I wouldn't, frankly, if I switched to some project that didn't have migrations, I would be forced to write a way to do that. Because it doesn't make sense to me now not to do that. When I deploy applications, watch this. This is how confident I am about deploying with Rails. All right? This is a live application that serves 200 requests a minute. And it's going to take the latest code on a certain branch and push it out to slash releases and then a timestamp. And once it's done with that and it's checked to see that everything is valid and all the migrations are ready and everything, it will actually change a directory called slash current, which is a symlink. People know symlinks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It'll change that symlink from the previous release directory to the new release directory, which is now being created.
Why does that say rn minus rn?
I don't see that right now, but I can tell you that.
Is that deployment process also built into Rails, or is that like a separate?
This is a gem called Capistrano.
Okay.
And you add the gem, and then there are a few instructions. I mean, you do have to configure that because servers.
That's the one that can like deploy to Heroku and stuff like that too, with Capistrano.
Yeah, Capistrano can do that. You can also deploy to Heroku. If I had another 15 minutes of demo, I definitely would have done a Capistrano Heroku deploy, because I could have this live, the blog application, for all you guys to post to within probably another 5 minutes if I really. Well, I can't because you guys are perverts. Any other questions?
Yeah, so you have an existing database, existing schemas. How hard do you have to manually write your migration file to kind of get it to a starting point with an existing database?
Tell me more about that.
Well, let's say if you come up with one of your clients. They want you to create a Rails app for their existing client database. So you're going to have to create those migrations to match the current schema?
Good question. No, you don't have to use migrations. Building a data, using Rails on top of an existing database that doesn't use Rails' conventions, my first thing that I would want to do, if it were, logistically feasible,
would be to switch everything to write a migration or a query or something to transition it to Rails defaults, because it is painful not to use the default, right? And rightly so, it's not meant to really just sort of take over existing databases. But if you couldn't do that because other people, I have actually been in on projects before where the interface between two applications was a database. One program would use it as its database, and the other program would come in and get their data and take it out. And so they, like, all migrations or database changes had to be carefully orchestrated. Terrible. But if you got some kind of logistical reason not to do that, you could make it work. And what you would do is set Rails up and say, okay, you would get a copy of the database and tell Rails to generate a sort of a master record that looks just like a migration, but it's Rails's track of, like, how do you get here? And then every other developer could use that file. They wouldn't have to migrate, go through all the migrations. They would just be like, spin that from that one file. And I showed it to you. So if you were building it on top of an existing app, there is a process for doing it. It's basically my story. Any other questions?
Last question? So I think I was passing by the beer garden earlier today, and I'm pretty sure they had a band playing, so it probably means there's a cover, so I guess we can head over to JSP, if everybody's okay with that. Thanks everybody for showing up. Ignite, Corey?
Yeah. Doesn't he want to give some announcements, some updated information for the whole community?
Matt, you want something to do or no?
I'm good.
All right. Jeez.
Hi,
Yellow
Roy. My name is Nicole Johnson. I have a mobile CPR first aid training business. I service clients throughout Louisiana. I'm actually wanting to transition my service model business to a broker model business, so just creating like a match.com type service to match people who need CPR training to instructors that are qualified to teach those trainings, and then scale my business nationally. I need a tech person to make that happen. I know nothing about that area at all. Everything that you just presented was like, blah, 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 blah. All that made sense to me. But anywho, so if you're interested or if you know anybody that's interested, I definitely don't have money to pay anybody, but I'm definitely willing to give up equity in my business. So if anybody's interested or if you know anybody, I have a ton of business card, definitely willing to chat with.
Just so that's what I got out of my presentation.
Somebody was going to say something, I'm sorry.
No, I switched your name.
Nicole Johnson. Nicole. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. So if you want to talk to Nicole, we'll all be over at JSP afterwards.
Anyone say something?
From somebody that.
Open floor.
That really sees all of these terms all day, every day, and doesn't know what they mean necessarily. The presentation was great because I've had people tell me, oh, I need somebody with Spring and Bootstrap experience. I'm like, ooh, okay, what's that mean? And it's like, oh, it's not really that complicated, it's just something. And it also can demonstrate how, like, you don't really have to be a rocket surgery person to get the concept of it. That's how they do it. But if, I guess one of the other openings and stuff? Well, I didn't want to know what the right model was, but I mean, we just, I'm a recruiter at CGI locally. If anybody, I've talked to a few of you people, but if anyone's openly looking, feel free to message me and ask if you fit for a position. Is everybody on the Slack channel?
I think so.
She
If you're not, you should let us know it's doing that.
If you're not, hit him up to get on it.
I troll a lot on that.
No.
I troll a lot on that.
But,
you're the one who gets trolled.
Yeah. But, yeah, I'm on there. Feel free to hit me up on that. Or andrew.dye@cgi.com. You can get to me, but I can explain like what he was talking, like some of the like Spring and I think Bootstrap, and there was a few of them, like stuff that he was talking about that there might be a difference between what you took in school or projects you've been working on and what hiring managers might be looking for a specific project, and then how to bridge that gap and like, you know, maybe working on a project and how you can just work on something and have a GitHub of it so that I can use to show to a hiring manager, hey, this person knows how to do this and this is a project that shows that they did it. Right now, I mean, we have mostly Java, Ruby, Python positions for his project, Azure, and AWS architect type stuff for another one, and junior.net, junior Java too. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Andy. Anybody else have any
Java
offers?
Yeah.
Actually, aren't you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my company in Chicago but hires remote developers, is always looking for junior and mid-level PhD developers and senior-level front-end engineers.
You can tell Eric to get over to his name this morning.
I know, his wife just had a baby.
Oh, right.
Like last week.
Anyway, unless anybody has anything else to say, I guess we'll go ahead and call it a meeting. Thanks everybody for showing up. Ignite.
Yes.
We're having Ignite in January. 5 minutes. It doesn't take much. We're going to get to talk about something here.